Most of you have read or heard Dale's story of leaving Adventism, and this afternoon I want to share with you my version of some of the rest of the story. I grew up in a fifth-generation Seventh-day Adventist Christian home in Phoenix, Arizona. When I was very young, I fell in love with Jesus. I loved going to Sabbath school and church. My third grade in school probably had more spiritual impact on my life than any other year in school. In Bible class, I learned about a woman who believed she received a call from God for a very special mission. I was inspired by the story of Ellen White, and I too wanted to hear a call from God to work for him. I gave my heart to Jesus one day when I was out in the pasture between my house and my grandparents' house. I joined a baptismal class and was baptized at the age of 9. Our church had about 12 steps with a foot-wide banister on each side leading up to the foyer in the main sanctuary, and children used to use that banister as a slide, even though we'd been told not to. And after being baptized, I slid down the slide, and my older sister Janine was at the bottom, and she scolded me, and we got into this little squabble. I was devastated. I wanted very much to be saved, and I knew I believed at that time that I had to be perfect to be saved, and I thought baptism would make me perfect. Why did I still want to fight with my sister? I was devastated, and I was worried. At school, though, I had just learned 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So that night, I told her I was sorry, and I asked Jesus to forgive me. But I prayed that prayer, a similar prayer, for many, many years, always asking Jesus to forgive my sins and to help me be ready if he should come back at any time. But I never went to sleep with the assurance that Jesus wanted me to have. When I was ready for high school, my family had moved from Phoenix to Oakdale, California, and my older sister and I were going to be attending Modesto Union Academy. On Sabbath, before the first day of school, on Monday, some girls were showing us the school yearbook, and my older sister, Janine, exclaimed, "Carolyn, there is your third grade boyfriend, Dale Ratzlaff." I was embarrassed and I was angry. We were in a new town, going to a new school, meeting new friends. Being reminded of a third grade boyfriend was not on my list of fun new things. I denied that picture I was looking at was of the same Dale Ratzlaff I had known and liked in the third grade. But in my heart, I knew it was, and I felt myself blushing. Monday morning, Janine and I were about the third group of students to get on the bus, and a couple of stops later, Dale got on. Janine poked me and said, "That is Dale Ratzlaff, and you should talk to him." She insisted. I wasn't about to do such a bold thing, though. But a couple of days later, Dale asked if he could sit with me on the bus ride home. This became a regular happening as we enjoyed the hour ride to and from school each day, and we began going steady. We often prayed that our relationship would be pleasing to God. Both Dale and I were reading Messages to Young People by Ellen White, and we believed this book held a special message for the young people of our day. I was so earnest, in fact, that my sophomore year in school, I would not allow my picture to be taken for the school yearbook. Dale and I responded to several calls of commitment to Christ, and at a youth congress one summer in San Francisco, we again responded and committed to being missionaries. Dale wanted to be a missionary doctor, and I wanted to be a missionary nurse. Dale stayed out of school a year to support his mother between his sophomore and junior year, and his family had moved close to Pacific Union College, and my parents were moving back to Arizona. I didn't want to go back to Arizona, and so I had applied and been accepted as a student at Monterey Bay Academy. I guess I did a pretty good job of persuading Dale to go there too, because now we were both juniors at the same school at MBA. That year, our teachers thought and told us that we must be getting too serious, and they wanted us to break up. So we did. We had to do this through notes, though, because of the very strict rules regarding couples in those days. Our letters to each other, though, which I still have, and actually they're in the book you have in your little packet, state how much we loved each other, how concerned we each were that we have God's will worked out in our lives, and we each ended our notes with a similar statement. If it's God's will that we get back together, then it will happen. And if it isn't, we wouldn't want it anyway. And you can read the entire story in our book. At the end of Dale's first year of college, we were married. On our honeymoon, we spent our first Sabbath in the woods reading Adventist Home. Dale had another year of college, and then he went into the hay hauling business, and then we went back to Arizona because Dale was going to help my dad with watermelons on the farm. While we were there, Dale had the life-changing experience that you've all read about or heard in his book, Truth Led Me Out. Well, one day, he gave me a reading assignment, and when he did this, I knew in my heart that he had decided to go back to college, although he hadn't said anything about that. The assignment he gave me was from Ellen White on all of the horrible things she said about life insurance, because Dale, at the time, was considering going into work with a company, a life insurance company. Well, when I finished the assignment, he then told me that he felt God had called him into the ministry and that we would need to move immediately to Pacific Union College. I was delighted. When I was only 5 years old, I adored our pastor's wife. She always hugged me and made me so happy I'd come to church. I said, when I grow up, I want to be just like her. I want to be a pastor's wife. After 3 years at PUC and then two at Andrews, Dale began pastoring in Santa Monica, California. We spent 3 years there, and then Dale was asked to teach Bible at Monterey Bay Academy. I became the administrative assistant to Principal Harvey Voth, and one of my responsibilities was to do the daily faculty newsletter. Always at the top, I had a quote from Ellen White, usually Desire of Ages. I was getting up at 5 o'clock each morning to do my devotions, and I was reading Desire of Ages, and so my quotes usually came from that book. Sometime during that time, our attention was called to diet, and we started reading counsels on diet and foods, and so I took that book of quotes. And we just were trying so hard to follow everything that Ellen White said, and we also believed others should be doing the same. Dale taught Bible there for 7 years, and then he was asked to pastor the nearby church in Watsonville. At this time, I sought employment with the conference, and I was accepted as a Bible worker, and my duties were to work with all of the area pastors, giving Bible studies and following up their interest leads. I loved my work, and I really enjoyed it. I saw many people accept Christ as their Savior, and there's no greater joy, I don't think, than to see someone accept Christ as their Savior. Well, one day, Dale told me he was becoming disturbed by the information that was coming to us regarding the investigative judgment doctrine, and stating that it was a non-biblical doctrine, and he wanted me to begin reading and studying what he was reading. I told him I wasn't a bit interested and that he better be careful because I didn't want him to do anything to cause me to lose my job. Well, troubling information just was filling our mailbox nearly every day, and one day I decided I needed to study the investigative judgment doctrine for myself. But I was not going to read any of this other material that was coming. I was only going to do it from my Bible. I got a roll of white shelf paper, Strong's Concordance, and my Bible. Started on the floor of our family room with this white roll of shelf paper and the concordance, and I started writing down all of the texts that had anything to do with judgment. And when I got to the New Testament, my paper was about 12 feet long, and when I read John 5:29, that was the clincher for me. He who hears my word and believes in me does not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life. That was it. Praise God, I said. Now I knew I could no longer believe in a judgment as understood by SDAs. But I also realized that this position was contrary to the SDA doctrines. All the time this information was coming to us, Dale was preaching good gospel sermons from the book of Romans. And one Sabbath, his sermon was on from chapter 11, on focusing on verse 11. Even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. It was a good sermon, and it filled me with hope and courage, as his sermons usually did. Monday morning, I was driving to a Bible study when the truth of this verse struck home with me. Suddenly, I realized that since God looks at me as if I'm dead to sin, who am I to argue with him? My thoughts that morning moved me to tears. I had to pull the car over for a few minutes. I thanked God for showing me that he wanted me to see myself as covered by the perfect righteousness of Christ. This new perspective did not mean that I was suddenly perfect. It did mean that God looks at any right thing I might be doing as if it is a filthy rag and sees only the perfect life of Christ because of my faith and trust in Jesus. If the judge has acquitted me, why should I condemn myself? The gospel was becoming the deciding issue. We realized we were going to have to choose between following a denomination that taught a false doctrine and following Jesus and the true gospel. This was a hard decision. Adventism was our life. We loved everything about it until we began to see the truth. We never thought there would be a dividing wall between Adventism and Jesus. The first step toward the door of freedom in Jesus was to realize that the 1844 investigative judgment doctrine was false. And the second step was realizing that since this doctrine was strongly supported by Ellen White, how could we believe the other things she wrote, especially since we were learning that she copied so much from others of her day? We spent many hours in prayer and Bible study during those days, crying out to God for guidance and assurance. The Holy Spirit spoke strongly to me one morning as I was reading in Matthew 10, and if you have your Bibles, I invite you to follow along. We're going to read Matthew 10, starting in verse 24. A disciple is not above his teacher, nor a slave above his master. It is enough for the disciple that he become like his teacher and the slave like his master. If they have called the head of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign the members of the household? Therefore, do not fear them, for there is nothing concealed that will not be revealed or hidden that will not be known. What I tell you in the darkness, speak in the light, and what you hear whispered in your ear, proclaim upon the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body, but are unable to kill the soul, but rather fear him who is able to destroy both body and soul in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a cent, and yet not one of them will fall to the ground without your Father? But the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So do not fear, you are more valuable than many sparrows. Therefore, everyone who confesses me before men, I will also confess him before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny him before my Father who is in heaven. And go down to verse 37. He who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he who does not take his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. When I finished reading those verses, I knew that we had to make a decision. It didn't matter what people were saying about us or how they were treating us. The important thing was that we be true to our convictions and the leading of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And we knew that our stand must be on the side of truth and following Jesus only. Together, Dale and I made the decision to leave Adventism and we have never regretted it. Now, I know with assurance that my sins are forgiven, and I am ready to meet Jesus, even if he comes today. There is no greater joy than following Jesus.